Lance Hall here for Let's Discuss with Lance Hall. Happy to welcome Johnny DiCarlo, lead vocalist for Never Wake, to the program today. How you doing, Johnny?
Hey, I'm good. How are you?
I am doing excellent. Still recovering from the time change, and you said you were too as we were chatting off air there for a second.
Yeah, I definitely we're actually scheduling a music video coming up here, and we were like, oh yeah, everyone be there by 6 o'clock because the time, it gets dark by 6, and people are like, hold on. Wait, not anymore now. And I'm like, dang,
yeah.
We're going to change that again. So,
oh, I tell you, just leave them alone is what I say.
Yeah.
You just released a video, though, for the song Call Out My Name, and I was looking at my notes, and all of a sudden this last-minute thought to me, this is about as organic as it can get. Your company shot and produced it, The Presenters. You got help from James Watson, who used to be in the band. You shot it in the basement of your childhood home. I mean, that's like a true DIY effort.
Yeah. that's really like, that's been us our entire career. You know, we've been basically like, when you're in a band, you don't have the funds to just like toss everywhere you please. You really have to be like really thoughtful of where you're going to put your money. And eventually you just go, well, what if we did it ourselves? What if we did it ourselves? Well, you know, we started this band like 10 years ago, and like I kept asking myself that question a lot for a lot of things. And so I went to college and I learned how to do a lot of stuff. So I learned, you know, how to mix music, how to create videos, and how to use all this software and stuff. So that's what we do now. We're like, we know what creative, you know, thought process that we have, and we can make it come to life without having to worry about handing it off to somebody else. So it's pretty fun to be able to be creative on all the aspects.
Very cool. And you pretty much answered my question. You went to Duquesne, right?
Yes, I did. So, yeah, I went to Duquesne University.
And that's where, so did you, was your major like music or?
No, I was actually thinking about music, but, you know, I've never been a music theory guy. And really, to get into music school, I mean, I don't know if it's changed now, but you know, to get into music school, like, you got to know music theory.
Yeah.
And I tried to learn when I was younger, but I learned like my father did, by ear. And I can't, once you learn by ear, it's hard to like to go the other direction, because you're playing from like meaning and like what you know. So I never really learned theory too much, so I never got into that. So when I was in Duquesne, I really just I got in touch with my sound design. I was taking a sound design class. It wasn't technically like a recording class, but Don Ma, he actually records people in Pittsburgh. Phenomenal human being. Taught me so much about Pro Tools and all this stuff. So it was just really cool to learn audio, video, photography, and even website stuff.
Yeah.
It was pretty sweet.
Nice. I understand, though, in high school, you were like the jock, the QB, who liked rock music, though, and, you know, it was mostly all the jocks like rap, but yet you met a couple of guys that are now in the band in a music theory class.
I did. So that's when, like, when we were in high school, I always tell people that we're like the Breakfast Club.
Yeah.
of bands, because I was the jock. I met a bass player in art class, and he was like this gothic kid in the corner, George.
Right.
He's actually my brother-in-law now.
Yeah.
He was just like this quiet kid. I remember seeing him one day. He was drawing a picture of Avenged Sevenfold. I was like, hey, dude, that's my favorite band. And he looked at me like double take. He was like, what? And I was like, yeah, dude, I like them a lot.
Yeah.
But I met Marcus Gianamore, our drummer, in music theory, because it was getting to that point in high school where like nobody knew who I truly was.
Yeah.
And until I walked in that music theory class, Marcus saw me, and he's this band geek. he's like, what the hell are they? What's he doing here? You know, and then I was just curious on, you know, hey, can I, I would like to learn a little bit more. I really didn't take much of it away.
Yeah.
I think the instructor hated me because they thought I was a jock too. But yeah, and then Justin joined the band later. We always like to say that, like, if there was like a mechanic class or something, if he went to our high school, like, that's what he would be. Mm-hmm. But it was just pretty cool. You know, we all come from different areas.
Right. Now, Justin came in when James left, right?
Yeah, James left, and then Justin stepped in. And it's nice because, you know, Justin provides something. He definitely brought something different to the table. We were never really like a gear-oriented type band, mm-hmm. but Justin is like a huge gearhead, and he's owned, in comparison to me, I've owned maybe less than 10 guitars in my life, and he's owned like 80. So, yeah, and he's like telling me, like, yeah, this is this and this is that, and he really brought an appreciation for music to Neverwick, and to be honest, he's the reason why our newest music is in lower key, 7-string, because I never would have played a 7-string hadn't he handed me his.
Mm. Very cool. I remember, I think, wasn't it Steve Vai who first came out with a 7-string around the time he was in Whitesnake, you know, where it really came into prominence, or was it out before that?
To be honest, I wouldn't know, because Justin would know, because he's the guy who was like, I know you're comfortable. You got your Schecter C1 Plus, and, you know, that's cool.
Yeah.
But give this a shot.
Yeah.
So, but I mean, I'm so glad that I did, because it helped break outside that, you know, that feeling of, like, oh, I'm comfortable here, and I only want to use this.
Right. I mean, the reason why I brought up the Vi thing, because I remember when he was working on that album, you know, I just gave it, like, a darker tone, that 7-string.
Reading about it and stuff.
So, yeah. So Call Out My Name is sort of going along. Is that going to be on the EP that you guys are working on right now, Misguided?
Yes, it is. It's going to be on that EP, Misguided.
Cool.
We are currently working on finishing that up. We are shooting music video within the next couple weeks for a next single. But yeah, that EP is going to drop here fairly soon.
Nice. The other thing I noticed about Call Out My Name, and I couldn't really figure it out, you know, of course I'm watching a video on YouTube and stuff, the vocal sounded really big, and I'm thinking, is this Johnny just kind of double-tracked, or is the rest of the band singing? I see a couple of guys are listed as vocals as well. Is it all you, or are the guys backing up as well, or what am I hearing?
Yeah, we all do sing. So whenever we go and we play live, we sing 4 mics. Or, well, 3 mics now, because Marcus technically, he just switched over to a headset mic, which is, you know, made his life a million times easier, because drumming and singing is hard enough rather than having to keep your head in place.
Johnny, you moved somewhere. I'm losing you here a little bit. And we're back after some temporary problems there. A little bit of a phone drop, I guess, is what happened. Back with Johnny from Neverwick, right?
don't. That's what's happening. Is it's infecting the lines now?
Yeah, exactly. We were talking about the vocal sound for Neverwick for Call Out My Name. I heard, like, you know, big vocals and everything, and you said everybody basically sings.
Yeah, everybody sings. We all take part in that, and it's hard to get a sound man that understands. You need 4 mics up on stage. Yes, we need 4 mics up on stage, and they're like, oh, you gotta put 4 more tracks in here and mix all that. But yeah, I mean, we're a singing band. We're you know, George is a screamer, but we are a singing band, and we all try to. We've got intricate parts, and we try to pull them off live as much as possible. We do a lot of overlaying, mm-hmm. so like you know, in a lot of our songs, even back, you could go back to Vitality, "Soul You'll Never Save." That's just one of the songs that's off there, and I'm thinking. Like, a lot of overlapping melodies and overlapping vocals, and it's hard to pull that off live, you know, because we'll be playing live, and they're like, oh, yeah, that part's happening. So we're fortunate that everybody can sing, and everyone can step in and say, yeah, I'll do that part while you're doing this part, and then I'll sing the harmony. So it's cool to divvy things up that way.
Yeah, and it must help you out and take a little bit of the pressure off of you as well. You don't have everybody sing.
Oh, yes, it does, for sure.
How about, like, lyrics and music? You all sing, you all play as well. Is it sort of an equal share? As you being the singer, is the pressure on you to do lyrics, or does somebody else bring in, and say, vice versa with music?
I mean, with lyrics, lyrics in our songs, they come last, because typically they come last. Songs, oh, I mean, I always get asked the question, where do songs start? How do you create music?
Yeah.
And there's never one answer. And it's stupid where inspiration can come from sometimes. Mm. You could hear something weird that sounds like, oh, that's a cool sound effect or something. That would sound cool with this. And then pretty soon you're halfway making through a song or whatever. Or, on the other hand, you have, like, something you see that pisses you off, and you have something in your mind, and you write about it. It could come from really any direction, but usually how we try to start songs mm-hmm. is we will start songs, we'll write them, and whoever starts it just takes it as far as they can go. Mm-hmm. And if they can go all the way, then great. We just step back through as a band and refine the song, and if everyone has, you know, nothing to say about it, no one, you know, criticize it or add something, we're just good. And then we go to the lyric process. But other than that, usually what's nice about our process is if we do get stuck, I'll hand it off to Marcus and I'll say, hey man, I have no idea where to go with this. Mm-hmm. And he goes, what about this? And usually he'll put something in there and I'll be like, oh, that's a good idea. Then let's do this. And then he goes, yeah, and then add this. So it's cool to, like, feedback and forth between people and get their ideas, and you build something together. But as far as lyrics go, usually I like to, you know, I personally like to write about anxiety and depression. It helps me because that's what I go through a lot.
Yeah.
And I do find that helps other people. So we're pretty happy with our writing process.
Excellent. John Moyer, of course, with Disturbed, produced Call Out My Name. I'm taking it he's producing Misguided as well?
Yeah, he did.
How'd you guys hook up with him?
We met him, okay, I want to say 5 years ago, maybe now, five, probably, yeah. We met him at a music convention, and we had no previous connections to him whatsoever, not at all. He was just going to be there, and we were like, hey, shot in the dark, let's email him, and we got his email off a, like, website or something, it might have been on the convention's website. We're like, hey, John, we're going to be there, we'd like you to listen to some of our songs. He's like, sure. So we're like, oh, sweet. So we met him at the bar that was attached to the hotel and let him listen to some music, and he was really interested. And it was cool because we made a connection there, and we had a couple drinks with him later at the bar. And then 2 years down the line, or however long down the line, I remember we were going back in the studio, and I was like, you know what? We told John that we would call him next time we were going back in the studio. Let's give him a call. Well, we called him up, and then we got something planned. We actually ended up delaying the studio so that he could come in and work with us. And it was just a really crazy, surreal experience because it was like, you know, I grew up listening to Godsmack and Disturbed and all these hard rock bands on my local radio station. Mm. And now he flew in, he's eating pasta with my family on Sunday next to my dad, where I grew up.
Yeah.
It was just a strange experience, but it was weird the first time that he came in, but then the second time, it was like, it was really cool because we were friends at that point, mm-hmm. and the way that we talked to each other was a little bit different. I always like to tell people, like, we're not, you know, it's not like we're all best buddies. Yeah, we got to listen to what John says. I remember last time he was in, I didn't want him to do something to this one song. I got pissed and I left. and then, like, when I walked back, he's like, I'm sorry. And I was like, I'm sorry. And we, like, hugged it out and we just, like, moved on. So it's just cool to have that relationship with him.
Absolutely. You know, it's kind of like a true family relationship, you know?
Yeah.
You toured recently with the Veer Union. How'd that go?
Oh, that was a blast. We had so much fun. Those guys are amazing. They really, you know, showed us the ropes on what to do. And it was crazy, just the way that it started out, because we literally started in Wichita, just right in the middle of the, you know, United States.
Yeah.
Hey, there you go. And then we drove across Iowa like 4 or 5 times. And it was just such a cool experience. We got to see so many people, and so many new fans came out to see us. Some people who had been listening to us for years, who had driven hours to see us, which is amazing.
Yeah.
You find out that's, you know, something that people do, because when you're a musician, you don't usually get this firsthand experience with people all the time. the majority of the time you're just like sitting at your house creating music, and you're like, I hope people like this.
Yeah.
Here you go.
Yeah.
And then you're playing out, and then all of a sudden these people are like, hey, we drove 8 hours to see you guys. We're like, what?
Yeah.
Really? So it was so cool. Such a great experience.
The first thing I thought of when you said you started in Wichita, I don't know if you've ever seen this. This is sort of a cult movie by now. Came out in, I think, like 1980. It was a cartoon movie called American Pop, and it followed these five generations of families through, you know, from like the 30s or 40s on up through to like, you know, the 70s. Had a wicked soundtrack to it. And in one scene, a guy from the city gets, I forget how he even ends up there, but he ends up in Kansas. And he gets out of the car or the train or whatever. He says, where am I? And they're like, Kansas. And he's like, Kansas? I'm in Kansas? If you've never seen it, it's a great flick. It's a great flick if you can find it even. You guys are signed with Melodic Revolution Records. Nick Katona, great guy. How'd that come about?
Oh, geez, that was through, that was a while ago, and we got that hookup through our management company, Atomic Cowboy Productions. At the time, Joe Macri from Crack the Sky had been working with Atomic Cowboy, and Joe knew Nick, and he was affiliated with some people through Nick, and we got to meet, and it was cool because, I mean, you sound like you know Nick. I mean, hey, he's not the type of guy that listens to metalcore. Like, he's like vinyl dude.
And, yeah.
You know, he likes prog.
Prog, yeah. He has a great prog show.
Yeah, yeah. And you know, it's just, it was weird because he was like, it's not really what I do, but I mean, you guys sound great, and I'd love to have you. And Nick has helped us out a ton. He's got a lot of good ideas, and he is such a great guy. First time we got to meet him was actually when we were open up for All That Remains. He came up to see us, and it was really cool. He was just like, so fired up, and he's an awesome dude, and we're happy that everything that he's done for us.
Yeah, I haven't chatted with him in a long, long time, but I used to Skype with him every once in a while, and just a great guy. Fabulous guy.
Oh, yeah.
So you're working on a release, you know, on Misguided, that's about ready to go. You're working on the video. Touring plans, I mean, we're talking on a day when literally it feels like the world is shutting down. You know, my son just came down. He's like, March Madness is canceled. The NHL is done. The NBA. You know, my daughter was supposed to do a competition up here in Vermont for states for gymnastics. That's just got the plug pulled on. What's going on with you guys with all this?
Well, I'll tell you what. We actually did have a tour planned that was supposed to start. Let me see. It's probably like 2 weeks ago. It was supposed to start. But some agents suck, so, and people don't do their job sometimes, so that didn't work out.
Okay.
We'll do what we can, you know, when it comes. So we do have some other touring plans in mind at the moment, but, as far as the, all this virus stuff and everything shutting down, we got no idea.
Yeah.
If people want to see us, I guess we'll do a live stream. Hey,
yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah, it's maybe what it come down to, you know. It's kind of a scary thing, you know. I think it's sort of like an unknown is the thing, you know, too. So
yeah, it's definitely scary. I mean, well, my fiance is a doctor, so she's, you know, I get all my news from her, and honestly, she's at the hospital every single day, so me staying in is really not going to do anything for
me. Right, yeah.
So, whatever. But, hey, we got to do what we got to do, and, you know, I just hope everyone stays safe out there. If we got to postpone things, we'll postpone it. I've seen all these other bands postponing stuff, you know, Slipknot, Trivium.
Coachella, everything, you know?
Yep. So. Yeah, it's all down.
Want to direct everybody to your website as well, www.neverwakemusic.com. Check that out. Very, very cool stuff there. Once the EP comes out, is there a way that people can buy it directly through you guys? I'd like to send people that way.
Yes, yeah. You can actually buy it at store.neverwakemusic.com. That's going to be there. And we actually have it available for pre-order right now.
Cool.
Online. Okay. There's two different pre-orders. There's one of them where you're going to get just the album, and then another one where you get this kind of special package with this wooden box, a key, and handwritten lyrics.
Nice. I got to give a shout out to a lady who says that you guys are buds of hers. She lives, I believe it's in Ohio, right near where you guys are in Pittsburgh there. And I'm going to try not to butcher her last name because we've never actually met. It's one of these Facebook friendships, but she listens to all my interviews and she supported me a lot and she supported you guys. Becky Kwiatkowski?
Yeah, yeah.
So, got to give a shout out to Becky.
Yeah, hey, thank you. Thank you so much.
Absolutely. I think she'll get a kick out of that. Talking with Johnny DiCarlo, vocalist here for Never Wake. The other thing I wanted to ask you, and I'm sure you're probably sick of talking about this, but I sort of remember getting turned on to you guys years ago with your cover of Thriller.
Mm-hmm.
You want to give me the cliff notes, how that came about?
Yeah, I mean, so at the time, we had never recorded a cover per se, and everybody and their mother, literally, it was actually my mother, everyone, it was my sister, you know, everyone's like, hey, you gonna do a cover? You gotta do this, and then they throw this idea at you, and I'm like, no. So we had just finished the actual album with John, okay? Mm-hmm. John's back in Texas. We're in, you know, we're in Steubenville. My sister goes, what about Thriller? Have you ever thought about doing Thriller? And I'm like, I just got fed up. I just stood up and I was like, you know what? I'm going to do this. And you guys are going to hear how terrible it sounds. and then here, you're going to laugh. So I started making it and I'm like, damn, this sounded pretty cool. And this is on a Saturday. I go in the studio on Monday with Mike Ofka at Innovation Studios. And it's 10 a.m. I'm tired. He's tired. We're about to start mixing the Incinerate album that we created. And I was like, hey, before you start that, take a listen to this. And I dropped my phone there, and I start playing it, and the intro is playing. And he hurried up and stopped it. And he goes, call the guys right now. And I was like, what? And he was like, call the dudes right now. I don't even want to listen to the rest of this. I know this is amazing. Get them in here. And I was like, I just started laughing my ass off because I was like, dude, this is never going to happen. Like, you know, George has to work. He's starting a new job. Marcus is at a, you know, 5 days a week job. Justin is watching his kid. So I text the guys. They had already heard it. I was like, hey, LOL, Mike wants us to record this. And George is like, actually, my job got moved back a day. I'm free today. And Marcus goes, yeah, I'm off today. And then Justin was like, Beth is home today for some reason. I don't have to watch Liam. So I was like, okay, can you guys come here and we can record this? Brought all of our gear back, recorded the freaking song. And in the midst of all this happening, I like called John and I was like, you know, and John was like overseeing the entire album.
Yeah.
And I was like, hey, John, we're recording Thriller. And he goes, what? And I was like, yeah, dude, we're recording Thriller. Don't ask me how this is happening. And I didn't even know this until after, but him and Dino called each other, my manager, after, and they were like, this is a terrible idea. Why are they doing this? You don't cover MJ. But, I mean, we had so much fun with it. I had my dad lives right next to the studio. I had my dad come in, and he did the Vincent Price part at the end.
Yeah.
He played the organ at the end. We had so much fun with it, and we got it done in, like, 5 days.
Wow.
And got it out by Halloween. So it was such a weird thing because it was the last song we recorded, the first song we put out on that album, and it was just like insane, but it was so much fun because usually when you go and you record an album or any kind of song, you've been sitting on that material for so long. You don't just like walk in there and like, here's the song, let's go. It was like from start to finish, 5 days out into the public. Such a fun process. I'd love to do that again.
Cool.
It's a blast.
Very cool. Johnny, I always like to end my interviews with just some fun questions. I'm hoping these are questions you've maybe never been asked. Sound good?
I love these. Please, throw them at me.
Favorite smell?
Favorite smell? Oh, my goodness. This is a tough one. My mom makes this dinner called chicken paprikash.
Mm-hmm.
And that's probably my favorite smell. It's amazing.
So I guess if I was to ask you if you could go back in time and eat one of your childhood meals that your mother used to make, you'd pick that?
Yeah. It, don't tell me that was the last, the next question.
It was. It's one of them.
Are you serious?
I'm dead serious. I ask that one a lot. If you could go back in time and eat one of your mother's childhood meals from your childhood, what would you pick?
Wow. That's insane. Yeah. Okay.
Good
right
stuff.
There. Two down.
Given your choice of household chores, would you rather do dishes or laundry?
Oh, geez. Probably dishes because I cook a lot and I like to know that I have clean dishes.
Okay. Hopefully your fiance wasn't listening there, right?
Oh, no. She knows.
She knows? Okay. All right. If you could have an extra hour in the day, what would you do with it?
Oh, geez. I already try to make that happen now, and it's not good for my health. So I would definitely say I would use that hour for rest, though, because right now I try to jam-pack all of my hours with I'm either doing something, music, video, animation, whatever, you know.
Cool. First car you bought with your own money?
Oh, geez. Well, I'm actually still using the same car that I've been using with the, it's a Mustang, 2006 Mustang.
Nice. Being from the Pittsburgh area, I think I know who you're going to say, but I'm going to ask anyway. Favorite old school wrestler?
Favorite old school wrestler?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Okay. I was almost crushed by Vader when I was little.
Really?
Yeah. I'm going to say him.
You're going to say Vader?
It's either him. Yeah, I'm going to say Vader.
I thought being old school, you would go, and being from Pittsburgh, you'd go with Bruno Sammartino, but he might be a little before your time.
Yeah, probably. I remember going when I was real young, and none of them really registered with me until the guy that almost killed me. So I was like,
all right. If you could blink and appear anywhere in the world, where would you like it to be?
Norway.
Norway? Why Norway?
Why Norway?
Yeah.
Because it's amazing and it's gorgeous. I would love to go there. Me and my fiance are thinking about, you know, doing a trip here soon, but I would love to go to Norway. It's just, I like hiking. I actually live in Morgantown, West Virginia, and, you know, I'm surrounded by nature.
Okay.
So it's one of my things.
Okay, cool. Current cell phone ringtone.
Current cell phone ringtone is actually a song that I have created. It's actually like a cyberpunk song that I made, and I put it on just because I think it sounds cool.
Very, very cool. Last one, and this is the one we have a lot of fun with. If they were to make a movie of your life, what actor would you pick to play you in the movie? And it's your movie, your life. You can pick anybody.
Oh, jeez. This is a tough one. Oh, who would I pick? Man. I don't know. I seriously do not know how to answer this question.
Okay.
Because I don't know who's like me or you know,
yeah.
Or it's, geez, this is a tough one. I'm just going to say Kit Harington just because he's a badass.
Okay, there you go. Sure. Perfect. All right, last one, just to sort of get us back to the music thing. If you had a young person come up to you and say, you know, Mr. DiCarlo, I really want to be a singer, a front man in a band, what advice can you give me to get me there?
Well, first of all, do it because you love the music, and always keep that in mind. You have to have the passion for it, because the passion is what drives your energy every single day to do what you got to do. If you don't have that passion, then you're going to be doing a lot of empty work just for nothing. Mm-hmm. And you're going to find yourself going like, why am I doing this? Why am I doing this? You know, this is not always glory-filled stuff. This is not always the best ride in the world. There's a lot of fun stuff that happens. There's a lot of great things that comes out of this, but it's definitely tough. And, you know, it's never easy. But it teaches you a lot. So I would definitely just say to gain a true passion.
Very good. You know, I was looking through my notes, scanning through as you were given that answer, and I do have one more thing I've got to ask you about.
Okay.
I read somewhere you're like a really big beer guy, craft beer guy.
I'm actually working on a craft beer promo for a festival that I'm doing the marketing for right now.
So,
yes.
In any of your extensive craft beer affiliations or trying or anything, have you ever heard of Hill Farmstead?
Uh-uh. No.
You haven't heard it? It's been voted like best beer in the world, like 5 out of 6 of the last years and stuff. It's a craft beer place, and I live literally, I can be at the brewery in 5 minutes from my house.
Oh, wow.
So,
well, I'll have to check that out then, because, you know, I'm all about the craft beer. It's the big, you know, I'm not like the hipster type thing where I got the huge beard and like, hey,
right.
This is most of whatever.
Tasting it through the snifter, you know?
Yeah, no, but I do love craft beer, and my buddies, we all actually love craft beer. We started out, it started out as a joke. We were bored because where we grew up sucked. We were like, hey, let's go out to Kroger, and there were 6 of us. We got 6 six-packs of stuff that we didn't know, and we were like, let's all give each other one and try it. Hated it all, but we ended up doing it as a tradition, and we ended up liking craft beer.
Nice.
It was a pretty funny way to get into things. And
well, check out that Hill Farmstead, or if you think it's something you want, let me know and I'll get you some.
Hell yeah, for sure.
All right. Johnny DiCarlo, vocalist for Never Wake, here for Let's Discuss with Lance Hall. Check out the video for Call Out My Name. It's on YouTube and everywhere else, and we'll look for that CD, Misguided, to come out soon.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me.
Take care, Johnny. It's been a blast.
Yeah,
you too. Bye-bye.